So we are now recording. My name is Sam Harlow. I'm the UNCG Library's online learning librarian. I'm also a liaison to community and therapeutic recreation, kinesiology, and public health education, which means I help instructors and faculty and students in those departments with anything to do with research, including helping with information literacy instruction. So today we're going to be talking about inclusive teaching and design practices in online learning. This has been a part of my research for years now, but of course in the last year has come up more and more to do with, of course, a lot of things that y'all all know about that is going on in the world. So I'm going to put some closed captions on this just so that we can all follow along this way as well. So here I am, my pronouns are she, her, hers, and I just want to state before we really get started into this that I am a white, cis identifying woman, and this conversation is important to have with a diverse set of academics, including BIPOC, Black, Indigenous, People of Color, and Differently Abled. I hope there will be other UNCG webinars and professional development, and I know there is some going on right now, with a variety of representation in the future about this important topic. So here is the presentation link. It is https://go.uncg.edu/OLinclusive. So if you want to follow along with me, there is a lot of links throughout this presentation. Typically when I have done this webinar in the past, I think all the times it's been with academic librarians, and a lot of times we turn this into an hour to an hour and a half workshop where we really kind of delve into stuff in more detail. But because of the length of this today, we're really just going to be introducing the topic. And again, y'all can go explore all of this stuff and links and ideas on your own. So to get started, and you're welcome to put this in the chat just so I kind of know and make sure that I'm covering as much as possible in the next 30-ish minutes. But what today are you hoping to learn about inclusive online teaching and design? And it can be anything. And if we don't cover it, I'm hoping that I at least can recommend you resources. I also know that there are, I think, some instructional technology consultants from UNCG in this chat who are also experts on online pedagogy and design and inclusive design. So if y'all have anything to add, feel free. And so the chat button is at the bottom of your screen. If it is in full screen mode for you, you can push escape and it will kind of, you know, make it go a little bit down, and then you can see that chat icon, and then the chat can be over on your right. So Olivia would like to learn about accessibility. Great. I'm gonna talk about accessibility. So accessibility is gonna be a huge focus, and we're gonna talk a lot about universal design for learning, a framework to think about accessibility and online learning design. I also will link you all to resources to learn more about accessibility, including in that we have a great accessibility coordinator at UNCG. Right? So someone's talking about gender neutral design. Yes, so any good design is gonna have that. So yes, great. Okay, cool. Okay, so just to make sure we're on the same page, I'm gonna go through a couple of definitions before we get started into the meat of it. So inclusive teaching refers to the ways in which pedagogy, curricula, and assessment are designed and delivered to engage students in learning that is meaningful, relevant, and accessible to all. It embraces a view of the individual and individual difference as the source of diversity that can enrich the lives and learning of others. So inclusive design refers to design that considers the full range of human diversity with respect to ability, language, culture, gender, age, and other forms of human difference. So like April mentioned in the chat, gender neutral design, but also being aware of all of the differences that we have. So the first thing I'm going to talk about, which is what Olivia brought up in the chat, is accessibility. So accessibility is vital for inclusive online learning. And we're going to talk about this today, but I don't have time to do a full, you know, accessibility presentation. So I linked here to an accessibility for all presentation that I typically do for librarians again, but again, it can apply to all academics or anyone teaching or designing online learning objects. But this webinar does go through all the details of ADA compliance and WCAG 2.0 and 2.1. So ADA compliance is that it's a law that us in higher education or all people in education need to make all forms of education accessible for all people. So WCAG 2.0 and now again 2.1, but they're pretty similar, are set rules about web accessibility in terms of online design, whether it's a course or a website, that states all the things we have to do to our online stuff to make it accessible. It's a set of guidelines, like a checklist that you can go through. So again, this presentation right here does take you out into a full hour-long workshop where I talk about both ADA compliance and WCAG 2.0. I also added a link on here to our UNCG accessibility webpage. So this was designed by, I think, some of the ITCs that are in this room, as well as our UNCG online accessibility coordinator. So it goes through, again, a lot of stuff about accessibility and the details, common accessibility issues, as well as universal design for learning, which I'm going to talk about in a second. It also goes over specific guidelines like I talked about. Again, these web accessibility policies from UNCG specifically, and then also specific things you can do to make your content accessible. We're not going to really talk about the nitty gritty today, but this is some great stuff. I use this all the time. You can also put in a request, and then I have found that our accessibility coordinator is very responsive. And I typically just email her directly, Melanie Ely, about anything to do about accessibility. But note that they do have an email address here that you could also use at any time to ask questions, anything like that. And also this website is great. So to think about accessibility, I like to think about our student population. So they're shifting in higher education. And the big thing I like to talk about when I talk about accessibility too is that disabilities are not always what you would think. A lot of times when I do these kind of workshops, people are like, yes, I have a deaf friend or a blind brother or anything like that. But note that actually, if you go out to the National Center for Education Statistics and look at the statistics we have about disabilities, they're a wide range, and a lot of them are cognitive, and a lot of them, don't necessarily affect you in terms of physical abilities. So designing, thinking through all of these things is going to be very important. So you can check that out later. Another thing to keep in mind, and this statistic was taken, I think, in 2018, where over 42% of American students take at least one online class. So we all know that that's probably a much higher number this year. And I personally believe it's probably not gonna go crazy down. I mean, after this year, of course, there won't be as many online courses, but I think now that people have tried online learning, seen that it can be accessible, that it can be flexible for our students, it's probably gonna be even higher than 42% with at least one person taking an online class. There's also an increase at UNCG and really all over the country on non-traditional students, which are working adults, veterans, and transfer students. Again, any student out of this typical like stereotype range we think of 18 to 22 year old students. It can also be people who are not financially independent upon their parents as well as parents, students. So again, keeping flexibility in mind is a huge part of accessibility as well. So another thing to keep in mind about accessibility is that only a quarter of students who received help for their disabilities in high school acknowledge in college that they need some assistance. And then according to this report, is that 70% of college students report a disability, which is a pretty low number. We have found that a lot of that means that students don't think that they can report cognitive issues or learning disabilities as a part of a disability to your accessibility office. So again, this all just goes to show you that designing inclusively and accessibly and making sure that it is universal in this way is very important. So another thing to keep in mind is something called an invisible disability, right? Which is a physical, mental, or neurological condition that is not visible from the outside, yet can limit or challenge a person's movement, senses, or activities. So again, keeping in mind that disability is not always something that we can see or sense. So before I go into talking about universal design for learning, I also want to talk about implicit bias in education. So this refers to unconscious attitudes, reactions, stereotypes, and categories that affect behavior and understanding. In higher education, implicit bias often refers to unconscious racial or socioeconomic bias towards students, which can be as frequent as explicit bias, if not more frequent. So here's some specific examples to get us thinking about how implicit bias can present itself in higher education. So some examples are, instructors may assume that certain students know to seek help when they are struggling, although students at higher risk for struggling academically are often less likely to seek help and support. Instructors may assume that students from certain backgrounds or social groups have differing intellectual abilities and/or ambitions. For example, an instructor might assume that a student from a certain background will be satisfied with lower achievement levels. Instructors may expect students who speak with certain accents to be poor writers. Students with substandard writing abilities may be stereotyped as lacking intellectual ability. Instructors might treat students with physical disabilities as if they also have mental disabilities and thus require more attention. Students who are affiliated with a particular identity group may be treated as experts on issues related to that group. Instructors may assume that students will best relate to the historical, contemporary, or fictional character who resembles them demographically. Students of certain groups may be expected to have certain participation styles, such as quiet, argumentative, or agenda-oriented. So, one thing to think about is that, when we talk about bias, particularly even with students, bias is hard because everyone has bias. So instructors can hold assumptions about students' learning behaviors and their capability for academic success, which are tied to students' identities and or backgrounds. There is a link out here to a Center for Teaching and Learning where they have a full page about awareness of implicit bias. And we're also going to talk about ways that we can get through this with online learning a little bit. So one thing to think through with all this stuff about accessibility, implicit or explicit bias, is thinking through something called Universal Design for Learning, or otherwise referred to as UDL for short. So UDL is an approach to curriculum that minimizes barriers and maximizes learning for all students. So this is an example from an academic, peer-reviewed scholarly article about library instruction to patrons, where they talk about implementing universal design for learning in their online instruction. So I like a couple of things in this, long quote from the article. One thing here is that they say is that the great thing about accessibility is that all learners have a better experience when accessibility features are utilized in online instructional materials to ensure that learners experiencing these barriers have access. So then the question becomes, what steps can be taken to make online learning more accessible? And they do give specific examples in here, right, about how universal design for learning or making things accessible in this way can help everyone. So I really like this image too when I'm breaking down universal design for learning. So when you think about the universal component, right, there is not just different abilities in terms of learning, there's also different learning preferences, right? It used to be called different learning styles, but again, over time, studies have shown that it's really preferences. So really, designing for everyone helps everyone in that way as well. We've known for a long time in terms of architecture and space design that designing a space that everyone can use is better for everyone. So it's the same with these online learning environments as well. Another thing that UDL keeps in mind is that the brain is diverse and has all these different parts of it. So thinking through how your instruction can hit your students in terms of multiple means of recognition, skills and strategies, and carrying and prioritizing is also crucial. So the way that UDL works, right, is that within your online instruction, in terms of your design or the way you teach, you're always thinking through ways you can provide multiple means of representation, action and expression, and engagement. So one specific example of that is that if you like video, keep in mind that your students might not all like video. So not only providing your students with video, but also providing them with textual options as well. So that, again, students can kind of see what they like or engage in these different ways. And that's just one example, of course. There's a lot of different ways this can come about. So one way to think about these UDL guidelines more specifically, right? Because I'm the kind of person that I'm like, yes, this is all great, but give me some examples of how this could work or how I can review my class. CAST, which is one of the major UDL, I would say producers of content or the way to think through UDL through education, came up with this CAST UDL guidelines that helps you review your classes online or face-to-face including your asynchronous and synchronous online design. So here it is, and I really highly recommend if you've never looked at UDL or thought about UDL, or even if you've heard of UDL but you've never really engaged in it, for y'all to look through this and think through it later. So note, one of the things I like about these guidelines is that it can be used kind of like a rubric. So I have seen like posters and conference presentations on, again, I'm in a library, so mostly librarians talking about how to apply this to their instruction. But you can see here that you could look through and see, you could start with one box, right? So if you're like, okay, I wanna start with build, I'm gonna look at how I can provide multiple means of expression and communication. So you can look here and click on this use multiple media for communication. And then it takes you into a full page and it gives you specific examples of what you can do to provide multiple means of communication, of media for communication. So here, like what I was saying, you can compose multiple media such as text, speech, drawing, illustrations, comics, storyboards, design, film, music, dance movement, visual art, sculpture, or video. It also gives you more checkpoints that relate to it. So if you're like, okay, I've thought about that, you can then go into the next one, right? Such as build fluencies with graduated levels of support for practice and performance. So again, I find this very useful. Okay, so now that we've talked about accessibility, UDL, implicit bias, we're now going to talk about equity and creating inclusive online learning spaces. And again, let me all know if y'all have any questions or issues in the chat. I'm trying to occasionally monitor that as well. So this was a webinar I attended from the Academic College of Research Libraries, University Library Section on Deficit or Equity, Decoding Implicit Thinking and Practice in Information Literacy Teaching and Learning by Amanda Folk and Sarah Miller. So though this was about information literacy instruction, I think this is a great framework that's adapted from this Benison article on closing the achievement gap in higher education to think through getting out of a deficit mindset when we think about our students, to thinking through an equity mindset. So a deficit mindset when thinking about teaching and our students is we focus on the stereotypes. We also blame students or their backgrounds for achievement gaps, and we also look at remediation. So then moving to diversity, which is again, what a lot of people are doing and is better than deficit, is focusing on the representation and frequency of differences. It's also a celebration of diversity coupled with colorblindness. And there's also a lot of workshops and sensitivity training. So this idea of fix the worker, right? Fix instructors, fix librarians, fix staff. But in an ideal world, we're really striving for an equity approach to thinking through our teaching, which is really focusing on the structures that process and create inequity, institutional responsibility for systematic racism, and institutional accountability for equity. So this idea that in an ideal world, we're fixing the culture and breaking down barriers that we all face in education. So here's another graph that's used a lot with UDL that I like to use to talk about equity. So equality is this idea that we give everyone the same box, right? So here is an example of how equality cannot work when we're thinking through our students and what we're giving them. So if we give every student the same thing, right, they still can't watch the baseball game. Equity is understanding that our students are different. And we need to provide them with different things to get them to the same level in order to see the baseball game. But really, in an ideal world, which again has been brought up in the last couple of years, especially with a lot of these pedagogies I'm talking about, is that we're ultimately striving towards liberation, which is getting rid of the fence, right? So that we can ultimately design in a way, like with using UDL and these strategies, that there is no fence in the way of our students and that they can just watch the game, which again, a lot of this is thinking through the structures in place in higher education and pointing these things out to our students in our instruction as well. So now that we've talked a lot about all these different things, again, sorry, this workshop can go very long. Here are some specific strategies to think about for inclusive teaching and design in online learning in higher education. So some things that you can do to be a more inclusive designer and teacher is that you can allow students to participate in self-reflective virtual exercises. So they may become aware of their learning preferences, personality types, different abilities, and preferred team roles. Again, these can be anonymous, they can be group work, etc. You can also develop online quizzes that reinforce important points and concepts and topics that are available for students to complete in their own time and at their own pace. And I would even challenge you to think through designing quizzes and assessments that do not require plagiarism tools or anything. Let the students look at stuff online. That can happen and can work in some ways. So another thing is provide multiple means of virtual support through office hours, additional learning opportunities, and extra credit, formative assessment, right? Like we all have to have that summative sometime, but building in formative assessment to improve throughout the course, and of course, answering emails. So one thing in terms of that implicit bias that we talked about at the beginning, again, that everyone has some, is that there is an implicit bias test where you can take it, and then it helps you become more aware of your bias so that you can name it and work through it in your design and teaching strategies. So you can also try something called blind grading, picture blind grading within the learning management system, where you could turn off the names and the pictures involved with your students in the course and blind, not knowing anything about them. Include a variety of perspectives and diversity within your online instruction content. So more are including a range of different learning, teachment, and assessment approaches and providing students with options to choose which they feel suit them best. Providing opportunities for students to reflect on their own experiences and consider how these experiences influence the way they understand. Scaffolding academic skills, learning processes, and assessments. So here lastly are things that I don't have time to talk about in detail, but a lot of people when they do these workshops can do full workshops on these different things. So one of them is something called transparent assignment design, which is really working with your students and having them, design the assignment with you. There's another thing that's happening in higher education, which again, I've actually never done it. So, and I don't think it would work in all classes, but called ungrading, where you let the students actually grade themselves. Again, it's much more complicated than that. And there's a link here to learn more about it. There's also a link here to that full webinar on decoding the disciplines, which again is kind of thinking through getting out of that deficit mindset and into a better equity mindset in terms of incorporating different things, but it's particularly critical theory, right? Kind of working through systematic racism and systematic oppression in your instruction. So another thing that I did not have time to talk about today is open pedagogy, which is having your students create final assignments or assignments throughout the course that actually contribute back to your field, right? And it also then teaches them about being digital creators, copyright, what they can and can't use from the internet and all that stuff, which also then goes into authentic assignments, which is this idea that some disciplines, some courses don't necessarily need research papers that students don't connect to them in the same way as these more authentic assignments, right? Giving them real world assignments that they'll use in their jobs. And then another thing is something called reflective teaching. Which is, again, similar to having your students reflect, you reflect on your teaching, whether it's after a lecture or at the end of a full course, at the end of the semester, looking through what you didn't like, don't like, you know, the student assessments, evaluations, looking through it in a way that you understand that they have biases as well, thinking through how you can improve. So again, other things I did not have time to cover are design thinking, which is a type of design strategy that really puts a focus on empathy for people who are going to be using your stuff. So you can look at that. So I mentioned open pedagogy, which is using open educational resources, which are getting rid of textbooks, right? Having your course be low cost or no cost. Some other things are trauma-informed pedagogy that might particularly be interesting for you to read through in a pandemic. And then anti-racist pedagogy, critical theory or critical pedagogy, which again is coming from this place of really questioning the structures around us and having that built into your teaching. And then lastly, indigenous pedagogy. And I think the UTLC just did a full workshop on that, and that link takes you out onto readings and more information about that. Okay, so we're right at 1:30. So you don't really have to go to the Menti. This is an example of polling that I like to do in a lot of my workshops. How many of you are in here? There's 9 of us. You're welcome to go out into there if you want it to be anonymous, or you can just put it in the chat. This is a safe space. But what, you know, now that we've talked about all this stuff, of course, it's not easy, right? I just threw a lot of stuff at you. So of course, there are still many challenges to creating this inclusive online teaching environments with our students. So I wanted to kind of think through what are some things that are challenging as we end this. So again, you can go out to www.menti.com or just throw it in the chat. If you go out there, there is a code. If you've never used Menti before, it's pretty cool. It's a pretty quick and easy to use polling thing I use with my students a lot for synchronous sessions like this. So again, you're welcome to go there, but really I'm just asking us what are the challenges. So for example, for me, when I think about this in my teaching, the biggest challenge is time, right? Is that, yeah, like there's all these resources and things to think through, but of course, rebuilding syllabuses, redesigning assignments, thinking through all these different ways of formative assessment, grading, engagement, making all this variety of online learning content, that takes a lot of time. So inclusive online teaching is not easy nor quick. So that's my challenge. Do y'all have others? I don't know if people are out in the Menti. Again, I'll go out there and see if y'all are participating. So yeah, someone did it. So someone said existing teaching materials that weren't created with inclusivity in mind. Yes. I mean, what I'm thinking about there is sometimes like you inherit a course from someone. And again, a lot has changed in terms of accessibility, our knowledge, and even our knowledge in equity, EDI initiatives, EDI is equity, diversity, inclusion stuff at our university. There's been all these new workshops, again, from our great UTLC and others about, again, all these different pedagogies and ways we can be better in terms of EDI with our teaching and inclusive online learning. But yeah, changing stuff is hard. And I know like April mentioned in the chat, gender neutral. APA 7, which is a citation style that's very heavy in the social sciences, right? American Psychological Association. They recently changed it so that they do recommend the use of gender neutral language to help with inclusive online writing and language, and that if you always are using the pronouns they when you don't know the gender or the pronouns of the academic or, you know, citation or anything like that. So that's, again, it's a shift, right? Like that's not the way I used to write in college. And this is a shift we're kind of asking of a lot of our students as well as ourselves, because now APA is, again, that's a rule in APA. So again, if y'all want to say anything else, I'll review the chat. Also up here, it's just www.menti.com. You can go on your phone and type it in 13, 11, 45, 8. So the end of this slideshow is just links out to specific things that can help you with accessibility. So again, a lot of these teaching and resource centers that give you full pages on how to think through implicit bias, how to think through equity and getting out of deficit mindsets. Again, a lot of these pedagogies I covered. There's also a link on here to a full bibliography. Again, the bibliography does have a lot of stuff about library instruction because that is where my research lies. But there is, of course, stuff on full just instruction and pedagogies and in general in higher education in there as well that could be useful. So some of the tools are specific tools that you can drop a website into things and it will check all your accessibility. We have a lot of accessibility tools and help within Canvas as well. And of course, there are some instructional technology consultants here, but you all have an instructional technology consultant that can help you with this stuff and lead you to the right resources and tools as well. So are there any questions, concerns? So I'm gonna drop the link to the presentation in here because again, it's just one of those presentations that has tons of links. And though 30 minutes might seem like a long time, it goes quick. So yeah. And again, here's the links to the stuff. So the big one is this WebAIM Wave Checker. You just throw a URL into there and it shows you all the accessibility issues. There's also a ton of Chrome extensions that can help you check accessibility. One of them being mobile design. So if you're afraid that your stuff isn't working well on a mobile, there's tons of stuff that you can check it on there as well. There's also a screen reader in NVDA. Melanie, our accessibility coordinator, can help you with this. She's done a workshop for us in the library on this where librarians play around with NVDA and see what it's like for people who are visually impaired to use that. So that's something you could download and play with. And then again, just more like stuff, resources. And the last thing I'll point out here is that there's something called Flow Project that, though I just don't want it to get lost in the links. It's flexible learning for open education, but it's really, again, looking at kind of this combo of OER, inclusive design, all these different things to kind of think through. And it takes you into a lot of different cool resources. Someone showed me this in a webinar about inclusive online learning, and I was like, yeah. So I use this all the time. It also leads you to this inclusive learning design handbook, which is really useful. And then April, if you want to, I found one in the library where there is a link. I think it's on a LibGuide I found that actually has stuff where you can check your language. So like if you're designing websites or courses, just not, even beyond gender neutral, thinking about creating inclusive language all around. And it talks about, even putting land statements within your course, things like that. So again, lots of stuff going on. Yes, I will find it. I took it out of this one because it was a librarian LibGuide, but I can find it again. So are there any other questions? Let me pull that up. This was a longer version of this I did in July. Questions, concerns, finding more links. Here it is. So here's a link to this resource. Again, I took it out because it's a librarian, but it's about creating LibGuides, these research guides we use to support racial justice and create inclusive communities. And of course, this can be useful to design as well. So I work with Twana a lot. Twana is great. She is the diversity librarian at the Diversity, Equity, Inclusion Librarian at Florida, University of Florida. But anyway, she has tips on here on to land acknowledgements, as well as the conscious style guide. That's what I was looking for, which demonstrates language inclusivity. It also has stuff on kind of thinking through what we're assigning students. And again, this is really from a lens of librarians, but you could of course use this stuff to think through your own syllabus as well. Okay, anything else? Okay, well, I'm gonna stop sharing. Thank you all for coming. My last thing is that you will all get a recording about this. Yes, April, it is awesome. The Conscious Style Guide is amazing. So you will all get a link with the recording to this, but you will also get a link to an assessment that is anonymous. So just let us know how you felt like this went. And lastly, I feel like I am, of course, doing my pitch late. I feel like my brain is so mushy these days. But our next one coming up in this webinar series on online learning and innovation is October 13th at 11 a.m. by April, who's in this room, on how to embed quizzes and quiz pedagogy. So that's the last one in the series because of how, you know, short this semester is. That is the last one. We're not really going full into November. We know everyone is busy. And then the next one coming up on research and application is by Anna, who's also in this room, on is this a quality journal to publish in? How can you tell? Where Anna is going to be talking about the publication and sharing of peer-reviewed journal articles is critical for many academic disciplines. Electronic content availability and open access practices have contributed to a large and growing community of online journals, but not all of these journals are created equal. So she'll talk through some things to think through when you're trying to get published. I can't wait. It's gonna be great. So if you wanna sign up for that one, here is the link to that series as well. I don't know if I said that, but it's on October 27th at 1 p.m. But remember, if you're interested in the topic, you can always sign up and you'll get a link to the recording. So that's it. Sorry, this went a little bit long. It's a miracle my kids did not interrupt this. Wow, or my dog, so great. Everyone have a great week. See you all later. Bye.